this is the straight edge, except this is marked. So Euclid's straight edge is just a straight edge. It's not a ruler. And this is a compass, and you can use it to draw circles. Straight edge can do the following. If you have two points in the plane that you have previously somehow constructed or given to you, then you can put the straight edge there and connect them by this, by a straight line. And the way we imagine it is that the straight line is infinitely long and the paper is infinitely big.
So you can't do a line of 20 centimeters?
Well, sort of. So that's a very good question. If you're given a line of 1 centimeter by God, then you can do a line of 20 centimeters because you can draw one long line, and then here's my line of 1 centimeter given by God. And then I can use the compass to measure the 1 centimeter, and then I can pick a starting point on my infinitely long line, and then I can put this 1 centimeter there 20 times. Well, now I'll just do it 3 times. So one of the central questions that people have been interested in for a long time is exactly what kind of lengths you can construct if you're given a line segment of 1 centimeter or 1 inch or 1 unit. Today, when you start learning mathematics, even when you're 2 years old or 3 years old, you always start with numbers. But for Euclid and people in his time, it was the opposite. They thought about geometry as being the basis of everything, and they thought about shapes, points, lines, triangles being the fundamental object. And they thought of numbers only as something that arises from the geometry. So the questions that they naturally ask were a little bit different. So first, I'll show you a few things that are possible. How about I give you a line segment of some length and ask you to construct a perpendicular bisector, meaning a line that's perpendicular to this line segment and cuts it into equal pieces. I have to open this compass quite wide because I drew this long line segment. So I draw one circle arc. So I do two circle arcs. The important part is that the width of the radius of the circle, so the width of the compass, was the same when I do it from the left and when I do it from the right. And then take the straight edge and just connect the two points where those arcs intersected, and they will intersect because I opened the compass wide enough to be wider than half. And then this line is a perpendicular bisector of that. So why is that? I won't show you all the proofs, but I will show you this one. If you connect all of these points, then what is this shape? Well, all of these red lines are the radius of the circle, and those are all the same. They are all the same length because I kept the compass the same width the whole time. And so this shape is what's called a rhombus. One of the properties of the rhombus is that the two diagonals are perpendicular to each other and cut each other in half. Another thing you can do, this is some angle, we don't know how big it is. We can't measure it because we don't have an angle measuring device, but whatever it is, I can bisect it, meaning I can construct a line which is right in the middle. So how do we do that? We take the compass, open it to whatever width, doesn't matter, draw a circle arc, and then from where the circle arc intersects those two lines, we draw another two circle arcs, and these two have to be with the same radius as each other. And then where those two intersect, we draw a line. And that line will bisect the angle. And again, so let me show you one last trick that's possible. So suppose you are given a unit square, and I tell you that every side is of length 1, and I ask whether you can double the square, meaning construct a square which has twice the area of this square. Okay, so how would that go? Well, what we want is a square that has twice the area. Now, what's the area of this square?
1.
1, because you get the area of the square by just multiplying the side length. So the area of this is 1. So if this has twice the area, then the area of this is 2. And that means that we know that x squared is 2. And so we know that x is the square root of 2. So how do we construct this square that's double the size? It comes down to having to construct a line segment of length square root 2. And this is where Euclid's kind of question starts to look more like your kind of question. Can you do a line segment of length 20? Now, his kind of question, can you do a square that's twice as big, comes down to a question, which is our kind of question, can you do a line segment which is of length root 2?
Can you do a line that's root 2 long?
Yes. So how do you do that? You draw a line. Okay, now we want a line perpendicular to it, pretty much anywhere. And one way we know how to do that is we can construct perpendicular bisectors. So if I just pick 2 points, doesn't matter at all where they are, and then I construct a perpendicular bisector to that little line segment, that will be a perpendicular line. And then we forget about those points. What happens if I take my compass? So I'm given this unit segment. That's the key. I know what length 1 is. And then if I know length one, what length 1 is, what happens if I put length 1 here and the length 1 here? So I'll mark those. So this is 1. This is 1. Can you guess what's next?
Yeah, you're going to do a hypotenuse.
Exactly. So this is a hypotenuse, and you can use the Pythagorean theorem. So this is, if this is C, then C squared equals 1 squared plus 1 squared. So C squared equals 2, and so C equals the root of 2. To finish the job, well, you would have to make a square that has this as a side length. So let's just make it a bit longer. We want perpendicular to it here and perpendicular to it here, and we know how to do perpendiculars. Draw a circle arc, draw another circle arc. Okay. Yeah. And then you'll believe me that I can do that on the other side as well.
Yes.
We have now 3 sides of the square. We just have to measure the side length. So put this in here. This is the length root 2. So I measure it on that side, and then I measure it on that side, the whole square.
Well done. That is job done.
Yep. So you can double a square. A question that you could try figuring out is how to triple a square. So it's very similar to this, but it involves a little bit of extra trickery. So it's a fun problem to think about. What's the first thing I showed you? It's how to bisect a segment. So instead of asking how to bisect a segment, I could ask, can you trisect a segment? So can you cut a segment into 3 equal parts as opposed to 2 equal parts? The answer to this is still yes. And it's actually pretty simple. I won't do all the perpendiculars properly, because now you believe me that I can construct perpendiculars. So I'll just do it the shortcut way. So open your compass to any length you want. Put another line which starts at the same point as the light segment. What the angle is doesn't matter whatsoever. Put your compass at the end and measure this whatever length, doesn't matter. 1 time, 2 times. 3 times. So now on this other side, I have constructed a line segment which is trisected by design. And then connect these 2 ends. And then from this point, draw a parallel to this red line. Now, I haven't told you how to draw a parallel, but a parallel is what's perpendicular to a perpendicular. So what you would do is you would draw a perpendicular to that red line here, and then you would construct a perpendicular from this point to that, and that would be parallel. And then another one from over here. And magic, where it intersects, trisects that original line. So the next thing, next natural question, I showed you how to bisect an angle. Can you trisect an angle? So I give you some angle. You don't know what the measure is because you don't have a measuring device. Can you come up with a construction which will result in two lines which divide that angle in three equal parts?
Well, based on everything you've shown me so far, I would have said yes.
Well, Euclid couldn't. And then for about 2,000 years, people thought about this problem. Before I tell you the answer, let me give you another problem. So I told you that you can triple a square. That's one kind of generalization of the problem of doubling a square. It's going up in the ratio by which you want to multiply. But you could also try going up in dimension. So a square is a two-dimensional thing. So instead of doubling a square, you can ask about doubling a cube. So what does that mean? Well, you're given a unit cube, meaning a cube whose sides are all length 1. And what you want to try to figure out is how to construct another cube which has twice the volume. Now, what's the volume of the unit cube?
1.
1, because you get the volume of a cube by multiplying this side length, and this side length, which are all the same because it's a cube. So that's 1 times 1 times 1 is 1. So if we doubled it, then the volume of the new one would be 2. So we don't know what the side length is, but we can figure it out. If the side length is y, then I know that the volume, which is 2, is y times y times y. So it's y cubed. Well, to get y, we have to take the cube root. So y equals the cube root of 2.
Can we do a cube root of 2? Can you do cube roots using a compass and a straight edge?
Well, who knows? Euclid couldn't, and then people thought about it for 2,000 years.
So both of these problems, Euclid couldn't crack?
Both of them Euclid couldn't crack. People were very curious about them, and many, many smart people thought about them. And then in the early 1800s, came along this ingenious guy called Galois. He died at age 19 in a duel. But before that, he essentially revolutionized algebra.
Before he was 19?
Before he was 19, yeah.
Wow.
So this theory, Galois theory, that he came up with is now, if you're in any math program in university, you're taught this in your, say, fourth year of undergraduate or first year of graduate studies.
I hope they also teach you not to have duels.
So that gave people the tools to eventually crack these problems. And they were it was proven in the 1830s that both of these are impossible. And the guy who proved both of these is called Pierre Wenzel. And you can see why they were so much harder. Because when something is solvable, all you need to do is come up with a solution. These solutions, they are tricky, but they are not that hard. But to solve that something is impossible, that's to prove that something is impossible, that's hard, because you can't, you know, saying that I thought about it for 10 years and couldn't do it is not a proof. Maybe you're just not smart enough. So you have to come up with something explicit that proves that they are absolutely impossible. And what it came down to is exactly your kind of question. What kind of lengths can you construct if you're given a unit segment? So I showed you how to do square root 2. I showed you how to do 3. I showed you how to do 1/3. It turns out that you can do all numbers that just involve fractions and square roots, and addition and subtraction. But there's a problem with cube roots. So what this guy proved is that you will never be able to do cube roots. And that can also be used to crack this problem, because trisecting an angle somehow comes down to cube roots through trigonometry.
So cube roots are the problem?
Cube roots are the big problem.
But the same question applies. How do you prove you can't do cube roots?
How do you prove that you can't do cube roots? That's a very good question. What do you use to translate from geometry to numbers is the main question. And the answer is analytic geometry, which you probably encountered in high school, so coordinates. you always start out with a unit segment somehow. Unit segment is always given to you to begin with, and then you want to construct other stuff. You can translate everything to the question, if you start out with a unit segment, you can construct a coordinate system that has the unit segment as like on the x-axis, and then which points can you construct from there, starting from there.
So cube roots are like an island you can't get to.
Exactly. So the question is, you can think about, instead of which points exactly you can construct, you can ask what are the coordinates of the points that you can construct. And each basic step, I told you what the basic steps are. It's like drawing a line between two points or drawing a circle. How are new points born? They are the intersections of lines or intersections of circles. And you might remember from high school that when you solve for the coordinates of intersecting things, this comes down to solving equations. And all of those equations will come from equations of lines and equations of circles, which also you might remember from high school or from calculus, if you ever took calculus. An equation of a line is a linear equation, and an equation of a circle is a quadratic equation. So when you solve those, you're never going to get cube roots. I'm going to fold it and fiddle it around. Okay, now once I found that alignment, I'm going to put my hand down and crease the line. Well, it's much less classical, and so it's less talked about, is to use folding paper instead of a straight edge and a compass.